So our plan is, we're going to work on teaching multiplication, but I'm not just going to show you, I mean, I could, if you wanted to, teach like I used to teach when I was a public school teacher, which is just writing numbers on a board and then giving you problems and worksheets and then I grade them and all that. But what I'm going to try to do is two things. I'm going to try to teach math so that you can see it, because my main goal is not only that you will see it, but that you will understand it. I was in a school once that had ceiling tiles like this, and the room was not a shape like this. So this is a very interesting shape. It was a rectangular room, and I asked the kids, these were fourth graders, I said, how many ceiling tiles in this room? And there were 7 rows, and there were 11 ceiling tiles per row. What do you think the kids did? I even had money on the line. I said, I'll give money for the first person that can tell me the answer. They counted them one time. They went, one of them, they were really fast counters. And then one little girl went, ooh, 7, 11, 77. So you see, even though these kids knew how to multiply, they didn't recognize that that's when they would use that skill, because they didn't understand multiplication. So multiplication, we're going to try to build it, and one way we're going to do it is using these blocks. Now these are 3 10 bars. How many do I have now? 4 10 bars. So we're going to be able to use multiplication to find out how many bars are up there without having to do what? Count them, right? Okay? Here's what we're going to do. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to teach you how to show a multiplication problem, and this is a what shape? Rectangle. Let's write it down, though. Rec, that comes from German. It means right, angle. What's an angle? It's the corner. It's where two lines meet, okay? So these lines meet right here. What kind of a corner is that right there? It's a 90 degree, or if you were younger, you didn't know what 90 degrees means, what would you say? It's a square corner. It's a right angle. And there's 4 right angles, so we've got 4 right angles. We call it a rectangle, okay? Would this be a rectangle? Does it have 4 right angles? Yes, it's a special rectangle, okay? So this is a rectangle, this is a rectangle. Look around the room, see if you can find 3 rectangles. Different kind. Okay, give me one over here. File cabinet's a rectangle. Where else? Speakers. What else? Lights. Whiteboard. Window. Rectangles are all around us, okay? So rectangles are a good model, but rectangles, when I was in school, if we had to find the area of a rectangle, what did you learn for the formula for the area of a rectangle? Length times width, base times height, right? So the base would be this, the height would be this, the length and the width. We're going to call those, instead of calling them dimensions, though, we're going to rename them factors. Okay? So the factors or the dimensions of this rectangle are how far across here? 10. How far up here? 4. And how many little squares inside is the area, but in terminology for multiplication, they would be the product. So what's the product of this? 10 times 4, 40. Good. So 10 times 4 is 40. And that's how we're going to illustrate a multiplication problem. We're going to build a rectangle. We're going to read the edges. Now let me just show you one thing so you don't... Those factors are skinny. They're just how far from here to here is 10, how far from here to here is 4, and then inside is the product. Does that make sense? Okay. Now, where does multiplication fit, though, in the big scheme of math? There's 4 levels of math. Some of you, this is going to be review, but I'm going to probably do it in every workshop. So, what's the level 1? Who remembers this from the last workshop? Counting. Abbreviation. Math is counting. You simply, how many chairs are in this first row? You count them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay? Fast counting of the same number, though, is adding. And what's the opposite of adding? Subtracting. So this would be the next. 2. So I could say, okay, if there's five chairs, okay, let's take people. That's too easy. You guys are all like in groups of three. Okay, the third row has three, and your third row has two over there. So how many people in the third row? I could have just counted though, couldn't I? I could have said 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Or I could say 3 plus 2 is 5. So that would be like adding. Not like it is adding. What's the opposite of adding? Subtracting. Now, let's pretend that there are 8 chairs in each row here. And I want to know how many chairs in the first 5 rows. I could count them, couldn't I? One of the professors would do like that. Or I could say 8 plus 8 is? 16 plus 8 is? 24 plus 8 is? 32 plus 8 is? And that would be fast adding of 8s, right? Or I could say 8 times 5 is 40. Okay? So fast adding of the same number is multiplication. And that is our definition. Fast adding of the same number. Okay? How can I lay a foundation then to get from adding to multiplication? One of the first things I do when I teach multiplication facts is I teach people to do what some of you were doing just now, skip counting. Let me show you some skip counting. Let's take these, for example. How many do I have in the first row? Second row. Okay, there's 3 in each row, but I could count them as I go. Let's just do level 1. Let's count them. Ready? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Okay, now let's just pretend we did that for a couple days. And then I'm going to say, now we're going to whisper the first 2 numbers and just say the last number loudly. Ready? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Okay? Now what we're going to do is after we practice this for a couple days, we're going to skip the first 2 numbers and just say the last number. Ready? 3, 6, 9, 12, 15. Okay, that's why we call it skip counting. So how many of you can skip count by fives? 5, 10, 15, 20. That's usually a common. How about tens? 10, 20, 30, right? How many of you can skip count by sevens? Yeah, a little tricky, right? So what I usually do, though, is I recommend that you not only learn how to skip count by twos, fives, and tens, which most people do, we skip count all of them. We learn the threes, fours, six, sevens, eights as well, nines. But you know what it does? It's laying a foundation for multiplication, because I don't encourage it, but you get stuck. You can. If you have 3 times 4, you could do 3, 6, 9, 12. You could skip count to find the answer. I don't recommend it. But it's also a practical skill. I was doing a workshop once, and there was a pharmacist there and a guy who did inventory. And the pharmacist says, I use skip counting every day, because I get the little pills and the thing. I go 4, 8, 12, 16, 20, 5, 10, 15, 20, whatever. And he skip counts. And the pharmacy guy says, I have to count how many boxes up in each shelf. And I find the one that's common to all of them, maybe like a 7. And I'll go 7, 14, 21, 28. And then I'll add the extra ones on top. And that's how he does his inventory counts every night. So it turns out skip counting is a pretty practical skill. You ever used it?
Yeah.
I often use it. In fact, I'd probably use it now. If I want to count on people were here, I'd probably go 3, 6, 9, 12, like that. So skip counting is a practical skill. It's laying the foundation for the concept of multiplication. Let me tell you what I mean by that. There was a teacher in Vermont one year, and she said, all my kids have memorized all of their multiplication facts. I said, good. She goes, but they don't know what they learned. They know 3 times 4 is 12. They know 3 times 5 is 15, but they don't know what that means. And so she taught them skip counting. I didn't know what to do. I said, try teaching them skip counting. It worked. She went, oh, now they know that 3 counted 4 times is 12, and that 15 is 3 counted 5 times. So they understood what multiplication was. Fast adding of the same number. That's your definition. So what is 12 times 13? Now, if you were in the last workshop, pretend you don't know it. But write it down. Don't say it out loud. What's 12 times 13? And you're not allowed to multiply to get it. I want you to think. Because most of you memorized 12 times 12 when you were in school, right? That's your first hint. It's your last hint. It's your only hint. Okay. James?
156.
How'd you get that?
12 times 12 is 144 at 12.
That's right, because I want to know what 13 12s is. 12 counted 13 times. Isn't that good? How many got 156? But you know what? I've had a lot of students that couldn't do that because they hadn't memorized that one. They only knew. And what I like is, like, let's say, for example, you're teaching multiplication by sixes, and you get to 6 times 6. And I've seen this happen, and the kid just freezes. 30, 35, 40, 40. They start throwing things out. Because they don't know how to think. They just know how to memorize facts. And memorizing facts is good, but what I like is when a child will go, well, I don't know 6 times 6, but I know 5 6 is just 30, so it must be 36, because it's one more 6. See, that kind of thinking comes from understanding what multiplication is, which is fast adding of the same number, right? Okay. So, skip counting teaches you that. It teaches you the concept, teaches you a skill, and it teaches you something you'll use. I also have a tape. If you're interested, we have songs to learn your skip counting facts. And we'll sing the threes now. I'll do it for you as a special favor. Here we go. Now, Nebuchadnezzar, I shrink his name to Neb. Okay? Okay. 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18, 21, 24, and 27 isn't counting fun. Da, da, da. Oh. Daniel, he had 3 friends who would not compromise. When everyone should bow, they looked unto the skies. Neb threw them in the fire. They did not feel the heat. Instead, they met the Son of God and worshipped at his feet. Oh, 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18. Okay. So if you want, I'll never be an American Idol, but the thing is, we do have songs, and they're all to some form of, that one's Jingle Bells, obviously, but we have the twos is Faith is the Victory. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, like that. You don't like my singing? Well, maybe I will never be an idol. But, so we have songs for all of them. Nines are going to Nineveh. They bowed in groups of 9. Anyway, I made it up. Okay, so we have skip counting. But skip counting is a really good step to get from adding to multiplication. It's like an intermediary step. It's a good one. I will warn you, though, when you learn stuff with music, you'll learn it quickly. It will go in your head immediately. But don't stop with the music. Otherwise, you're going to be like this. Okay, what letter comes before L in the alphabet? Yeah, that's exactly right. Everybody goes, K. And, you know, because when you learn something with music, it works. But it makes you have to play the whole record to get the information. I don't want you to have to skip count and go, 18. And I've watched kids do this. They go, and then I know that they're skip counting because they always go up for 18. 18, 21. Okay. So you want to practice on not just singing them, but say them in a monotone so that you could say dead part. And if you want to understand it, you can ask Linda Kane. She'll tell you the same thing. When you sing, it goes into one hemisphere. When you say them, it goes into the other hemisphere. And you want them with the saying hemisphere, which is your logical side, not your creative emotional. So 3. Let's try it. 6, 9, 12, 15, 18. Very good. Now, when I was teaching my one son, he could not get his multiplication by 3. And the way I teach is that you don't move to the next one until you get those down. Okay? So we were teaching, and he just could not get those 3 facts. And so we did all kinds of things. We would write them. After a while, I said, okay, Joe, you know how to skip count by 3? Yeah. I says, okay, I'm going to say the problem. You just say the answer. 3 times 1, 3. You do it. You be Joseph, ready? 3 times 1.
3.
3 times 2.
6.
3 times 3.
9.
3 times 4.
12.
3 times 5.
15.
You see? So we did it auditorily. We did it visually with the blocks. Eventually, he knew that 3 times 7 was 21. 3 times 8 was 24. But, you know, if you get your multiplication facts down cold, that is the way that you're going to be able to do double-digit multiplication painlessly, because you don't want to be doing too many different things. And that's my thesis is, when I teach a new topic, I only want the kids to be focusing on one new skill. And we're doing double-digit multiplication in a minute. I don't want them thinking, oh, shoot, 3, 6, 9, 12, 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18. Oh, yeah. And that they shouldn't be thinking that when they're doing these big problems with four of those in it. You see what I mean? They should have multiplication down cold. Now, I hate to tell you this, but you need to memorize multiplication. If you forget, and sometimes I will confess, if I'm really tired and I'm having to add, I'll go 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Okay? Sometimes, not usually, but sometimes I will count. You can find answers, and you even have fingers. I don't encourage that either, but worst comes to worst, you can do it, right? You can't do 7 times 8 on your fingers. You need to learn those multiplication skills. And I was a high school teacher, and I had so many students that they could learn the algebra and they could learn the geometry, but what held them back was they couldn't multiply and do fractions. And math is sequential, and you need to make sure that you get your foundation. So place value, adding, subtracting, multiplying, dividing, when you have those down cold and understand them, then the rest of the stuff is not tough. Okay? Did I make my point? Are you going to memorize your facts, Alexis?
Oh, good.
Okay, we'll get another workshop on that tomorrow. How about you, Mark? What's that?
Destruction to algebra.
I can see where my audience is going to be tomorrow. So, you coming to that one tomorrow?
Yeah.
Good. Okay. I like a challenge. I don't mind being heckled. Okay. So, let me just give you some tips for learning your multiplication facts. One of the first things I do, though, I teach multiplying by 0 and 1, right? That's the obvious. They're very easy. And because they're easy, though, it's a good opportunity to teach the symbols, which I recommend that you learn the symbols, all of them. The floating dot and the two parentheses. So we could do 3 times 4, 3 times 4, 3 times 4. Now, there are certain things you'll learn in lower-level math, like subtrahend and minuend and divisor and dividend and all that, and quotient and all that, you'll never use again. But you will use these. You will use them in algebra. You'll use them in trigonometry. You'll use them in geometry. You will use these symbols over and over and over. So the sooner you learn them, the better. I just teach them right in the beginning. And I think one of the reasons is I had a kid freak on me once in pre-algebra. And we introduced some of this symbolism, and he says, "No one ever showed me this." Anyway, so I don't want to cause anybody to panic again, so I just teach all these three symbols right from the start. The twos are very easy as well, right? Because they're just doubles. And if you've learned how to add, you know that 7 plus 7 is 14. So 2 counted 7 times or 7 counted 2 times. You also need to teach in the early days the concept of, okay, what would this problem be? If you were writing the problem that this is representing, how'd you write that? 2 times 4 or 4 times 2, right? How about this one? Oh, you mean it's the same thing? So 4 times 2 and 2 times 4 are the same thing? What do you call that? The commutative property. Not commutative. Communion is what you have in church. Commutative. No, it helps you to spell it. Commutative means if you're driving 10 miles to work this way, how far is it coming home? Still 10. The direction doesn't change the problem, all right? So I would say this one is 2 times 4. What's this one? 4 times 2. It's the same problem, right? So how many math facts are there to learn in multiplication? I mean, let's say that we had a grid, and we had this grid, and you have time, you know, 0. Let's do it this way. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay? And then we do the same thing over here. In fact, we can even add 10, okay? The 10s, but they're pretty easy. So how many math facts would there be there? Well, this is really 11, right? Times 11, that'd be 121 math facts. But let's forget the 10s, they're easy. If we could take out the zeros, either one. How many math facts now? There's 9 plus 1, so there's 10 times 10 is how many math facts? 100 math facts. So here you'd have 0 times 0, 1 times 0, 2 times 0, 3 times 0, like that all the way down. Then you have 0 times 1, 0 times 2, 0 times 3, right? Which one did I start with? No, I'm putting these numbers first. You're right. What would that be?
One.
What's the next one? One times one. Two, we've got a pattern going here. Good. Three times one. Okay, the reason I'm showing you this chart is if there's 100 math facts, if you learn that 0 times 4 is the same as 4 times 0, you don't have to learn two facts, right? So you teach the commutative property as soon as possible, and some kids do not grasp this. When they see 4 times 2 and when they see 2 times 4, they think they're two separate math facts. So you have to teach this, okay? So how many math facts are there if we take out all of these because we've learned them down here? There are 55 math facts, okay? If you learn all the zeros, now we're down to 45. If you learn the one facts, we're down to 36 because we already don't want that one, right? If you learn the two facts, now we're down to 28. Is this getting easy? Okay. Now I'm going to teach you the nine facts, and we're going to have a little fun with this one. Okay, let me show you 9 times 1. Okay, here's 9. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. Okay, so there's 1 times 9 is 9, okay? Now, I want to do 2 times 9, but I'm already out of little green ones. I've used them all up. What am I going to do now? Add a 10? Okay, why would you want to take away 1?
10 is 1.
Oh, okay, so if I could just add this 10, that's too much. So I take 1 away, that evens it up, right? Okay, so now how many do I have here, everybody? So 2 times 9 is 18. All right, let's try that one more time. What's this one? Oop, I take 1 away. Now what do I have? So 3 times 9 is?
27,
okay. Let's try it one more time. What's that? So what do you think, looking at this pattern developing here, what would 5 times 9 be? How'd you get 45? Okay, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5. Okay, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Let's try it and see if that works. So we add a 10, and we take 1 away, and we have, you're right, 45. Nice job. Okay, let's try one more. 6 times 9, anybody? 54. Okay, now there's two things going on here, is that these numbers are declining, these are increasing. How many pieces did I have up there in the first problem? 9. How many pieces of wood are up there now? 9. Because every time I add a 10, I take 1 away, I keep the same amount of pieces, right? There always will be 9. And that teaches me that what's 5 plus 4? 4 plus 5? 3 plus 6? You get it? Okay. Okay. Well, let's keep going here. So let's say if we jump down here to like 9 times 9, which is, but let's pretend we don't know it yet. Let's look for a little pattern here. I'm going to write these a different way. Let's look for a pattern. Because what I'm thinking is, okay, what would 10 times 2 be? 20, but this is going to be less than that, right? So here's a little shortcut you might think of. 9 times 3, would that be more or less than 30? How much less? A lot less or just a fuzz less? A fuzz less. So 9 times 3 would be 20-something, right? 20-something. And what's 2 plus what makes 9? 7. So let's try this one now. 9 times 4, 10 times 4 would be 40. It would be a little bit less. So I go down to 3, and then makes 9 be a 6. Let's try this one. What would 10 times 7 be? So 9 times 7 will be more or less? A lot less or a fuzz less? So what number should go here? 6, right? 6 plus what makes 9? You're right. Let's try 9 times 9. Go down 1. What makes 9? Okay, who didn't know their 9s when they got here? All right, good. Let's try you. Ready? 9 times 5. Go down 1. Okay. What? Perfect. Who else wants to try one? You already know your 9s? Oh, good, good, good. No, I want to teach you that. Ready? 9 times 8. Let's go down from 8, just down 1. Good. What makes 9 if I add to 7? 2, right. Get it? Everybody got your 9s done now? Okay, if we've learned our 9s, now we have what we have. We had 55, and then 45, and then 36, and 28. And now we subtract 7, so we've only got 21 facts left. 21 facts. That's it. And then in those 21 are the, you know which ones I do next? What do you think are the next easiest after the 9s? 5s. 5s are easy. And then that makes you only get 15. You know what, folks? There's only about 15 math facts you really have to work at. And if you skip count them, and if you can build them with rectangles, and let me show you how to build some of these math facts. Let's say, okay, how much is this right here? 4. I'm running out of yellows. And that's a 4, and that's a 4. So if I want to do 3 times 4, I could do like this. I could say, well, I could have a rectangle that would be 4, 8, 12, or 3, 6, 9, 12. And I could build it, and then I could write it, and then I could say it and practice it. Or I could even do this. I could say, well, I've got 4 plus 4 plus 4 is the same as 10 plus what? Oh, I already used the 2, so 10 plus 2, 12. So you can build them in terms of place value. You can put the tens beside them and the units at the end. And I remember, I don't know if Ethan remembers this, when he was a kid, we had lots of blocks. And we put like 4, and then we went 4 plus 4, and we put an 8. And then we went plus 4 more is 12, plus 4 more was, and that was 16. And then we'd add 4 to that, and we made 20. And we made all the math facts with blocks. And here you got 4, 8, 12, 16. See what I mean? So it really adds a dimension to it when you can build it not only in terms of rectangles, but also linearly in terms of place value. And if you want, you could even turn these sideways and say 1, 10, and 6 units. Add a 4 more. So the next one would be 20, and then 24. It's kind of fun. That help? Okay, now here are some free ones for those of you that came today. And these have no pattern, and they have no rhyme or reason, but they really are neat. Here they are. What do I do? I need to have 2 symbols in this one. Here we go. I don't know why it works, but it's great. Okay? And it was one of the 15 we hadn't learned yet. Okay, how about this one? What do you do to that one? Same thing. 56 equals 7 times 8. My mother taught me that when I was a little girl, and that's the number that ever came. Very good. And I don't even know where I saw this, but anyway, there's 2 free ones for you. So now we're down to 13. And really, there's only a few facts that you have to work on. And when all else fails, if you've only got 15 facts, that's about how long the summer is, 15 weeks. So you take one fact per week. I've done this with one of my sons. I said to him, look, he couldn't get 6 times 7, which I think is one of the hardest ones. If somebody tells me, well, I know how to multiply, I say, okay, 6 times 7. Because that's like the killer one, you know. And so He couldn't get it. So I said, okay, 6 times 7 is 42. I'm going to ask you that at breakfast, when I see you at lunch, I'm going to ask you at dinner, when I pass you in the hall, when I go to bed. And I just took that one fact all day. By the end of the day, everybody knew it in the house, because every time I saw him, what's 6 times 7? 42 is what? 6 times 7. 7 times 6, same thing as 6 times 7. What is 6 times 7? 42. You know, and all it takes, put it in the bathroom, put it above the sink, put it on the ceiling when you're lying in bed. I'm telling you, it just, when all else fails, just do it and memorize it. Okay, once you have your multiplication facts down, now we're going to do multiple-digit multiplication. Multiple-digit is, we did some of this in the last workshop. Only one thing will be really radical in this workshop. Okay, this is a rectangle. How far up? How far across the top? Does everybody see that that's 12? That's 10 plus 2. And what is 10 times 12? Do you see it? 120, right? Okay. How about this one? How far across the top? 11. How far up the side? What's 11 times 11? 100, 2 tens, 1 unit. You see that? What shape is this? It's a square and a rectangle, but a square, right? Here's some algebra for you. This is just for you, okay? This is 11 once, twice, times itself 2 times, 11 squared. And that's why they call it 11 squared. I am now confessing. I used to teach algebra. I never knew that until I saw it with the blocks. But that's why they call it squares, because it makes, yeah, sorry. Anyway, there you go. So let me try a tougher one now. This is yours, Mark. All yours, baby. Okay, how far up the side? Good. How far across the top? Good. So what we've got is 11 counted 13 times, or 13 counted 11 times, right? What is that? What's this? Just, yeah, tell me the whole thing. I'm just going to take it apart if you want. Okay, what's this? What's this red one here? Okay, how many hundreds you got there? 100, good. Now, how many tens do you have? No. There's one. I just wonder how many blue ones there are. 4. How many green ones? That's the answer. So 11 times 13 is 100, 4 tens, 3 units. Okay? Got that okay? Now, I don't recommend you do this, but this is the kind of stuff I do when I'm on a trip by myself and there's like nothing to do. I give myself problems like this. I do. And I'll go, okay, 17 times 13. And that's the over and the up. I go, and I build these rectangles. And I can see this one right now. It's 100. There's 3 tens. There's 7 tens. So that's another 100, 200. And then there's 3 times 7 in the corner, 221. Now, I'm not endorsing this. I'm just telling you this is what a strange math guy does. But the main reason we use the blocks is not so you can entertain yourself on trips. The main reason to use the blocks is so that you can understand the symbols. And so we're going to do a little different problem than we did last time. Okay, write this one down, everybody. See if you can figure out yourself. You're find the factors and then find the product. Find the edges and then find the inside. Okay, because you don't carry blocks around with you. Right? Let me see if I can make this point. I used to have one friend come to workshops. He goes, don't you get dependent on the blocks? Do you use them too much? I say, well, yeah, I go to the bank. I says, give me 3 red ones, 2 blue ones. No. The thing is, if I was to use total blocks, you would become dependent on the blocks, just like if I was using an abacus or a calculator. If I use total pencil and paper, which is how I was taught, then guess what? I can't do math without a pencil and paper. And if I don't have pencil and paper, I go like this. right? Because that's how I was taught. So what I just want to make this point. As soon as you build it, then you write it, and then you say it. If you're doing all three, then eventually you won't need the blocks because you'll understand what the numbers mean. Am I making my point? Okay. So how high is this one here, everybody? 12. How far over is it? 14. Okay. Now, when you do double-digit multiplication, what you really have is two numbers times two numbers. You're going to have four problems here. And they call these parts of the product, or they call them partial products. You get that? Partial products means parts of the product. So in here, how many different color rectangles do you see? Well, you're right. There's blue, red, and green, but there's actually two blue ones, right? So you've got one rectangle, one rectangle, one rectangle, one rectangle. You have four different rectangles. Because you've got 2 times 4, 2 times 10, 10 times 4, 10 times 10. See that? So these up here are what we call the factors, right? And this is our little up factor, and this is our over factor. But the factors times the factors gives you down below the big product. Now, if you really wanted to, and you don't like the way I'm going to do this problem, you could come over here and say, you got four problems. You've got 2 times 4 is 8. You've got 2 times 10 is 20. You've got 10 times 4 is 40. You've got 10 times 10 is 100. You add them all up, right? That's called partial products. That's the part of the product. And you know what? Henry, I think it was, who's the guy that made the, Ford. Henry Ford said, there's no such thing as complex problems. You just have to break it up into smaller problems. And so what they do is, though, this is kind of a big thing what we're going to teach you right now. But if you get tired of big things, break it up into smaller chunks. That's all mathematicians do. They're not smarter than anybody else. They just know how to make it into easier problems. Okay. So let's try this now. We have 2 times 4 is what? 8. But before I get into this, can I add units to tens? We talked about this in the last workshop. In the decimal system, you can only add tens to tens, and hundreds to hundreds, and thousands to thousands. I'll give you an example. What's 300 plus 400, Lori? 700. Okay, Heather? What's 3,000 plus 6,000? All right. Mary, what's 300 plus 3,000? Very good. Because you can't combine thousands and hundreds. You just say 3,300, right? Okay. So I can't add these little units to the tens. I can't add the tens to the hundreds. What do I have to do? I have to scoot them over. So now I'm going to put all the tens together, all the hundreds together, and all the units by themselves. All right? Is it the angel choirs? Heavenly music? Okay, so 2 times 4 is what? 8. So I can take this away and put an 8. 2 times 10 is 20. So I'm going to put it in the tens place. 10 times 4 is 40, which is why I had to move this over, because that's in the tens place. 10 times 10 is 100. See that, everybody? So the reason that you shift that bottom line is because you're multiplying by 10, so you have to start in the tens place. Yes, ma'am? Yes. Okay, I didn't either. Okay, the first time I taught sixth grade, remember I was a high school teacher, then I worked back. The first time I taught sixth grade, I said to the kids, I don't want to mess you up. How did the teacher teach you to move over the second line of a multiplication double digit like that? And I got three answers. First one was, Mrs. Wilson said to do it. Okay. I'm serious. The second one was put an X there. And the third one was roll over the barrel. And they would put a zero, and that was the barrel or something. Anyway, and I said, does anybody know why we're doing this? Nobody knew why, the whole class. They just had all learned their little tricks how to do it. So let me go back. So what we had was, we had two tens here, we had four tens here, and we had eight here. All right? First of all, thank you for asking me to do that again. And that's what I want, feedback. Good. I'm trying to show that concept that the second line has to be moved. And the reason for it is two reasons. The first one is, when I'm multiplying 2 times 4, that's units times units. I use units instead of ones. Okay? So you could say 2 ones times 4 ones is 8 ones or units. Okay? Then when you get 2 times 10, which is this one, 2 times 10, that's good. And that's exactly how we're taught to multiply, right? You take this guy and multiply it by these two. So you have 2 times 14. 2 times 4, 2 times 10. But this whole thing is 2 times the line. That make sense? And then the next thing we're taught to do is multiply 10 times the whole thing. So we have 10 times 4, 10 times 10. We've got 10 times 14. That make sense? So now you have 10. I could even put these numbers up here. That's kind of cool. So I get 2 times 4, 2 times 10, 10 times 4, 10 times 10, right? Get the four rectangles. But at this point, I can't add units to tens. And I can't add tens to hundreds. So I have to move them over. So now I have all the place value in place. I've got all the units, 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 tens, 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 and I get the hundreds over here. Did that click? So then once I have them all moved, then I can take away the parts and put the 8, the 2 tens, the 4 tens, the 100, add them up, 168. Let me do one more. I'm going to do the same problem. I'm just going to write it a different way, I mean. I could write as 10 plus 4. 12, I could write as 10 plus 2. And I've created a term for this because I haven't found anybody. It's not expanded notation. I call it place value notation because I can take each number, like 168, and write 100 plus 60 plus 8. And then I see the hundreds, the tens, and then, okay? So this is easier to me because what's 2 times 4? 2 times 10. 20. 10 times 4. 10 times 10. And I add them all up. Right? Mm-hmm. And then I take the eraser, take these away. And that's exactly what we did a minute ago. But that having the tens and the hundreds in there emphasizes the place value. So let me stretch you a little bit here. Try this one. You ready? Let's talk about it, though. What's 2 times 4? What's 2 times 0 tens? 0 tens. What's 2 times, what's this? 100. Where would it go? It would go in the hundreds place. Very good. Now let's take 10 times 4. 40. What would that go? Right here, right? And if you want to put a 0 there, this is still a free country. Go for it. Okay? And what's 10 times 0? 10 times 100. 1,000. So where would that go? That would be over here. We'd have a 0 for the hundreds, right? I mean, you don't have to do a lot of these. The main thing is just getting people and getting the students to start thinking in terms of place value. Because I'm assuming, as I said before, that they can multiply 2 times 4 and 2 times 1. I'm assuming that they have their multiplication facts down. This is really all about place value at this level. This is about place value. How am I going to eat dinner now? Okay. Well, now you're all awake. So now let's go to the next topic. What's that? Okay. That's right. Did I do something to stimulate that? because I don't want to do it again. All right, let's try a tough one now. This one, you're going to have to stay with me. Okay, everybody ready on this one? How do you do multiplication when there's regrouping? What I mean is, let's say you have something like 37 times 24, and you have to do 4 times 8 is what? 28. Where do you put the 8? Here. Where do you put the 2? Why? Okay, I'm going to show you an alternative way to do these, okay? So I'm going to show you this problem right here. 13 times 15, and I'm mainly showing that because that's all the blocks I have. Did that work? Yeah, okay. So 13 times 15 . Okay, so I need to put a 15 up here, and I've only got 3 5s. So I'm going to have up 13. Okay. I'm going to have like this. I'm going to have this. And I need some more 10s. Oop, right there. Okay, so what's the first thing I do? Is everybody in the right place? I've got units, tens, tens, hundreds. No, I've got to make my shift, right? Okay, so I've got to shift this line. I'll just move these up a little bit. I'm going to shift this over to here. And I'm going to shift this over to here. Remember why we just did that? Why we do that? Place value, because I got to have my units, my tens, my hundreds, right? Okay. My problem is that I'm only allowed to have 9 in the units place. And how many do I have there? 15. What do I have to do? I need to take, how much is this if I take this away? 5 and 5 is, so can I replace that with this? Okay, so now I can take this out and put that here. But where does he belong? He belongs in a tens place, so I'm going to slide him over to here. Is that okay? Now I can do it, right? So how many hundreds? 1. How many tens? 9. How many units? 5. Okay, so I'm going to give you a different way to write this now. And I'm just going to tell you this. You don't have to do it this way if you don't want to. It's still a free country. But I'm going to make a case for why I like it. So if I had 13 times 15, what's 3 times 5? 3 times 10? 10 times 5? 10 times 10? Okay, now look at this and look at this. Does it look the same? You got 5 units. You've got 1 10, you've got 3 10s, you've got 5 10s, and you've got 100, right? It's the blocks that showed this to me, okay? That sounds funny, didn't it? As I was using the blocks, I noticed something. That's better, isn't it? Okay, because the blocks don't talk to me. That was really kind of getting scary there. If the blocks start talking to me and I'm building them in my head and we're having conversations and everything. No. Okay. Okay. No. Shh. Might burp again. Don't laugh too hard either. Hold it. Settle the boy down. You better watch out, Mark. He's right behind you. Okay. Let me explain this one more time. Most of the time we were taught you do this. You do 13 times 15. You do 3 times 5 is 15, put the 1 here, put like that, right? Then you say 3 times 1 is 3, plus 1 is 4. But you know what you just did? You just did 2 operations, didn't you? You had to multiply and then add. And for some kids, and I never would have thought of this, but a 6th grade teacher told me, she goes, oh, this is so good. 3 times 1 is always 3. I looked at her and I says, when is it not? She says, well, sometimes some of my students think it becomes 4. in certain situations because you're having to multiply and then add. So what I'm suggesting is if you do this way, you do all the multiplying first and then all the adding second. So you do 3 times 5 is 15. 5, 10, right? 3 times 10, it's exactly the same. And then you just add them all up and you go like that. So I'm giving to it as an alternative. But the blocks revealed this as I studied them. Okay? It is different, though. And what I'm finding, though, is it's easier for me to do that. And for some students, you don't have to mix operations. You do all the multiplication above the line, all the adding below the line, boom. I'll give you a tip. Unless you have graph paper, you can just turn your notebook paper sideways. Whenever you do big multiplication problems or big division problems, turn your paper sideways because place value is everything. Where you put those numbers will make the difference in the whole problem. So that's what I usually do. Turn the paper sideways and work it. Let me give you a bigger one like this. Try it yourself just once. What do we have over there? 36 times 27 or something like that? That's close. Try that one. The new way. Okay, when you're done, you can watch up here. I'm going to do it. Okay, 7 times 6 is 42. I put a 2 here, 4 here. 7 times 3, 21. Put a 1 here, 2 over here. 2 times 6 is 12. 2, 7, 9. Is that right? What's that? And I don't think there's one right way to do it. I'm simply, this is a workshop. We're exploring some options and giving you some alternatives. And especially if you've got some kids that have trouble with this. Because the other thing you'll notice, as a teacher, most of your mistakes happen right up here. Is when you are leaving numbers up there from before and then you're scratching them out and you don't know which one you're supposed to add and all that. Mm-hmm. This way it's eliminated because you just put all your work down here. It is a little bit trickier to keep track. But that's why if you have your paper turned sideways and you've got the lines coming down, as long as you know which column they go in and what place value, you're good. So it's an alternative way to do it. That is radical. But again, it was the blocks. It's the blocks that told me that. So maybe that's why it's radical. I'm going to blame the blocks. I'm a victim talking blocks. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, I do it both ways. And the thing is, what I'm finding is, I met a girl from China. And we were talking to her about importing something. I didn't do it, so you can all relax. But anyway, I had the blocks, and I was showing her how we use the blocks, because we were getting bid. Maybe she was going to make our blocks and stuff. And she goes, oh, you know how we do this in China? Okay, so what is she doing? She multiplied by 10 first. Yeah. So 10 times 13 was 130, and then 2 times 13 was 26, and then she added them up. Now, to me, I thought, cool. I learned a new trick. Not a trick, a new approach. And have you ever seen Swedish subtraction? It's a different approach. I've learned stuff in Hungary. And I get to travel, and so I ask people questions about different things. Now, to me, that is good because I expanded my knowledge base. I've tried to show that to fifth graders, and you know what they did? I'm not kidding. They put their hands over their ears and they started humming. They didn't want to hear anything. They says, I got one way to do it. I don't mess with me. So I'm simply telling you this because if you go home and show this, you know, like this, to a sixth grader, if they understand math, they'll say, cool, I get that. If they are struggling and they've worked really hard to memorize one way, don't mess with them. They got enough going on. Their hormones are changing and everything else. I'm serious. Teenagers, I've found that if you're like fourth or fifth grade and under, they're still teachable. But when they get older, they want to know one way and then get out because they got enough going on with their system. So that's just practical advice. I think I would like to learn four more ways of doing it. I mean, there's a Columbus method of doing multiplication where you write the numbers I mean, we could do a whole workshop on just different ways of doing multiplication, but they take like, it's grids. You take like 123 times 24, and it's all stuff like, yeah. But when you look at it, what they do is they do the multiplication in here. They like put the 6, and then they add them this way, and they put the answers down here. And it's just place value again. And once you look at it with understanding place value, you'll see that they're adding the numbers this way to get the units, tens, hundreds, thousands. And it's just place value. And I think it's a little confusing. But there wasn't, I mean, when God created the earth, he didn't show us how to do multiplication problems. And there's this whole development process that Pythagoras came up with this, and then Zeno came up with this, and Isaac Newton came up with this, and they built on each other. And what we have is taking a long time to develop, and it's slick, but most of us don't know where it came from, and so we forget. And that's why I try to break things down so you see the origin and the background. To help? Okay, now we'll close with the little shortcut fun trick. Here you go. If you don't know this, when you multiply by 11, right? All you do is you split them and add them. Split the 2 and the 3 and then add it. That fun? So try this one. 44 times 11. Just 11s. What's the answer? 484, because you split them apart, you add them up. Split them and add them. You want to know why that works? What's 11 times 23? 23, 23, right? There's the 2, there's the 3. You add them up for the middle term. Now, there is exceptions. This won't work if you have 99 times 99. Because you split them up, and what's 9 plus 9? 18. You can't add 18 in one thing. But you can put an 8 there and add 1 to that if you really want to. But these only work if the numbers add up to less than 9. But it is a fun one. Split them and add them.